Keeping track of your blood pressure is one important step to maintaining heart health as you age, but taking an accurate blood pressure reading isn't as easy as it may look, and many mistakes are pretty common. In this video, we will look at over 18 mistakes that can occur when having your blood pressure checked that can cause a false reading. Also, real quick before we get started, it would mean the world to me if you hit the like button down below for the YouTube algorithm, turn the bell on next to it to stay up to date with new weekly videos. The reason why this is so important to you is because how you prepare for a blood pressure test, the position of your arm, and other factors can change a blood pressure reading by as much as 10% or more. That could be enough to hide high blood pressure, start you on something you don't really need, or lead your doctor to incorrectly adjust your medicines. It's crazy because this procedure is performed millions of times a day across the country, but very few medical professionals, even nurses and doctors, nail the routine correctly. So in this video, we're going to go over everything that you can possibly do to make sure that you get the most accurate reading and avoid mistakes. And the mistakes are going to be broken down into three categories: patient-related, procedure-related, and equipment-related. So let's start with the first one, patient-related mistakes. Before you get your blood pressure taken, the first thing to remember is the 30-minute rule. No smoking, no caffeine, no food consumption, no alcohol, and no exercise 30 minutes prior to the test. If you've done any of these, you want to make sure you give yourself at least 30 minutes before the test, because if not, these will likely raise blood pressure, contributing to an inaccurate reading by as much as 10 points and up. Secondly, you're going to want to make sure that you don't have the feeling of peeing. You want to make sure you empty out your bladder before the reading too, since this could also add another 10 to 15 points, which is sometimes overlooked by a nurse or doctor to ask if you have to pee or not before they even check. Thirdly, you want to go into it with as little stress as possible. Give yourself 10 to 15 minutes to clear your mind in a quiet room and practice some deep breathing before the test. Now, those pretty much sum up the patient-related mistakes. Now, let's move on to the procedure-related ones, which are just as important to get right. The first mistake you want to avoid is talking and active listening. Once you're about to test, it's better to avoid unnecessary talking. The room should be quiet too, where you have nothing you're listening to. Talking, believe it or not, contributes to a higher inaccuracy than smoking does. Same goes with listening. Talking can lead to a 7 to 10 point increase, and listening leads to a 5 point increase. So avoid the talking and the active listening. Secondly, the temperature has to be right. This study that looked at the association between indoor temperature and blood pressure found a 1 degree Celsius decrease in indoor temperature was associated with rises of 0.48 millimeters per mercury in systolic blood pressure and 0.45 millimeters of mercury in diastolic blood pressure. So as a good rule of thumb, you'll get more of an accurate reading if you stay above 21 degrees Celsius or about 69 degrees Fahrenheit. So that's the second one. Thirdly, let's talk about time of day. Blood pressure is often highest early in the morning, 5 a.m. or 6 a.m., so you may have to choose another time to take it. Morning blood pressure is also generally higher if you have sleep apnea, so keep that in mind too.
Sleep apnea actually is a pretty common condition, which is most likely underdiagnosed and underevaluated because many people don't realize that they have it.
Every time I stop breathing, she's, you know, the next morning, sleep apnea. I'm like, what is sleep apnea?
So a good rule of thumb is to have it checked twice a day at times most convenient to you, at least two readings at each time. So that's the third one. Fourthly, you got incorrect positioning. To achieve the most accurate readings, have patients seated with their backs and arms both supported, preferably with an arm approximately at the level of the patient's heart. Cross legs add 2 to 8 points. No back support adds an extra 6 to 10. An unsupported arm adds 1 to 7. Here's what I found. Interesting though, if the upper arm falls 15 centimeters below the level of the right atrium, readings can be artificially high by 10 to 12 millimeters per mercury. Conversely, if the arm is above the level of the heart, readings will be falsely low. So you gotta make sure the arm is positioned as close to as in this diagram here. And lastly, the white coat effect, which is real. And this happens when you get a high blood pressure reading at a doctor's office and a normal reading at home. Sometimes the anxiety of being around doctors in white coats can make your blood pressure artificially rise.
Blood pressure is going to go up because you saw a white coat. It's also going to go up when someone cuts you off in traffic, when your family stresses you out, when you're stressed out at work.
But it often occurs with nurses taking the reading too, which is why home monitoring may be great, since you can actually check your blood pressure throughout the day and at times that are most convenient to you. And you can share these results in some of them, since some of the kits actually save all of your information in them, like the one by iHealthTrack, which is not sponsored, but one that I like that lets you save all of your data on your phone, lets you email records to your doctor, and has unlimited storage with the app that goes with it. You can pick this one up in the description below as my affiliate link if you wish to do so, as it greatly supports the channel. Now let's move forward to the equipment related mistakes. The first is the cuff size. The blood pressure cuff should fit over about 3/4 of your upper arm. It should easily go around your arm and the Velcro should close tightly. If your cuff doesn't fit properly, it'll lead to an inaccurate reading. And this is a diagram to make sure you're picking the right cuff size. Measure the circumference of the middle of your arm and pick the corresponding cuff size. The second mistake is the blood pressure machine has to be calibrated every 2 years, right? The user manual tells you how to do this, as each machine will be different. If you have doubts about your machine calibration, take it to your doctor's office and they should help you calibrate it. And lastly, make sure it's going on a bare arm. This is debated whether or not it matters, but for accuracy's sake, don't measure it over clothing, especially thick clothing. So those are really gonna sum up the equipment related mistakes. And in total, we counted about 18 mistakes in this video. Like I said, there are a lot of different factors that can tamper with getting accurate results. Knowing how to avoid these mistakes will hopefully get you a more accurate reading next time. One of the most important steps that you can take to ensure you're getting an accurate picture is to measure at the same time every day. Record your blood pressure daily and report any changes with your doctor. I'm more curious to actually hear from you guys though. Let me know what your thoughts are on this topic. I would love to read them down below. And in the meantime, guys, subscribe if you found this video helpful, and I'll see you on the next one. The third method is by improving the nitric oxide levels in the body. Nitric oxide is a molecule that the body produces naturally. It supports blood circulation. It also helps deliver nutrients and oxygen to every part of the body more effectively. And it's easy to boost nitric oxide by incorporating foods rich in dietary nitrates.